Good afternoon. Welcome to the NWO webinar about the NWO Talent Program VD. Thank you for registering yourself, and you are not the only one. We expect about 275 participants this afternoon. My name is Rosemary van Kempen. I'm the coordinator of the NWO Talent Program. And I will start later on with a presentation about the VD. First of all, we will start with some Mentimeter questions, but let me first introduce my two colleagues who will assist me today with answering your questions about the VD. They are my colleagues Jimmy Mans of the domain Social Sciences and Humanities, and Oliver Stockhammer. He is the VD program officer of the research department, the health research department, ZonMW, as we say in Dutch. So the program will be that we start with some Mentimeter questions, and afterwards I will give this PowerPoint presentation. Later on you can ask your questions by the chat function in the Zoom. As I said before, there are a lot of participants today, so it will be unrealistic that we can answer all your questions. But no worries, the last slide of the PowerPoint will give you an overview of the email addresses of the different domains. Anyhow, I would recommend all the new researchers to take a close look at the call for proposal and the application form, because these documents will give you a lot of information. The call for proposal is leading. The information in the call, in the Dutch call, is leading. So the things we say today, well, I presume they are all conform the call, but maybe there's a slight difference. If you have any questions afterwards, you can also email us at one of the email addresses I will give you later on. So, let's start with the Mentimeter questions. The first one. We would like to know in which domain you are planning to apply. Great. Well, I can see that this confirms the experience we have with the past rounds. The biggest applications amount will be in the social sciences and humanities, and that's the way we are used to, following by the science domain and the health and research. Well, it doesn't matter anyhow. I'm glad to see that many of you already have some idea where to apply. The next question. Do you have a permanent appointment at Dutch University at this moment? And this question I ask because there is a compulsory embedding guarantee. We ask for a VD. Later on in the presentation I will tell more about this. Thank you so far. The next. Will this be your first or your second attempt for a VD application? As you may know, you have 2 attempts to apply for a VD. Thank you very much. And the last one. What subjects are you most interested in for hearing about today? You can give 1 or more keywords. Thank you very much. I can see that there are a lot. There's a big need for more information about the knowledge utilization, the impact outlook approach. Later on, I will tell anything about it. But anyhow, I can now also tell you that there is a large introduction paragraph in the call, and also in the application form, you can find more information. Thank you very much. I will go on with the presentation. So the VD, first of all, who can apply? Well, the VD is open for the researchers with several years of research experience. Every researcher of each nationality can apply for a VD, but you must be aware of the fact that if you come from abroad, and your VD is granted, you must do the research at one of the Dutch universities. The VD is an open call, so there is it's not bounded to any theme. It's all scientific disciplines are possible to apply for. Well, what can you ask for? You can ask for 800,000 euros, and this means a part for your own salary, a part for scientific staff, and some money for eventually equipment. As I said before, you need an embedding guarantee from a host Dutch university to apply. And this guarantee you must upload with your application. The attempts for a VD is twice. So you can't, if 1 year you're not successful, don't worry, you can try another year. So more information about the VD you can find on the described link here. When to apply? This year we have the deadline on the 2nd of November. Earlier years it was in October, but due to the COVID situation and the hack of NWO, we postponed the deadline with 1 month. Beware that the deadline is at 2 o'clock in the afternoon sharp. The reference day for the eligibility still remains on the 1st of October. And before uploading your documents, check if you have met all the terms for submission. If you have all the right documents uploaded, so the embedding guarantee. And does your application follow the format and the criteria? So the page limits, the word count, all these things are very important to check before you upload your application. The embedding guarantee. Since 2018, we ask for the VD and also for the VENI an embedding guarantee. This is compulsory. So you need to fill in this form and let it sign by the dean of the university you want to do your research. And the content of the embedding guarantee states that if you have a tenure track appointment and you receive a VD grant, you will receive afterwards a permanent contract. On some grounds, you can ask for an extension. And this extension is a maximum of 5 years. So if you have had a period in which you needed a leave for care or sick reasons, or you have had a clinical specialization, you can ask for extension. And these hours you spend on this leave will be compensated. We also have an extended clause for parents. So biological mothers receive 18 months per child, and other parents receive 6 months per child. But before that, you need to fill in a parent declaration. This parent declaration you can find on the website, and you can send it to talent@nwo.nl. A little overview of the assessment procedure. So we start with the call, and the call is online, as you have seen on the NWO website. The application, you upload your application before the deadline, and then we ask external reviewers to look at your application. In some cases, or more especially for the domain of the social sciences and humanities, we also have a procedure of pre-selection, and this is in case the amount asked for is 4 times more than the domain can grant. So then there will take place pre-selection. Anyhow, with the full application going to the external reviews, if we receive these reviews, we will send it to you as an applicant, and you can have, 5 days to write rebuttal. The rebuttal, the external reviews, the application is a set of documents which will be assessed by a committee. A committee will afterwards, on basis of all these applications, all these documents, make a selection of candidates who they want to see in an interview. These interviews are mostly on fixed days, and you will receive on due time a notice if you are invited or not. After the interviews, the committee will make a ranking and an advice to the decision board. If your application is granted, you receive the funding. If your application isn't granted, you can try again the next year, or otherwise there's no other possibility, unfortunately. Well, a little bit about the application form. Since 2 years we have a narrative CV, which means that you are asked to write a description of your academic profile. You are free to consider what you're relevant to describe in your CV. For example, you can describe and explain what kind of researcher you are, what is the focus of your research, what is your vision, and what have you done to realize this vision until then. Also, you can describe what you think is important and what demonstrates your qualities as a potential VD laureate. Grants and prizes, you can mention them, but not only to indicate what you have done with this grant or prize. So it's not allowed to give a complete list of all the publications or prizes and grants you have received. I already mentioned publication, that's the next phase. Because the narrative CV is so what I mentioned before, but also the key output. You're asked to give 10 key outputs and not only list them, but also in a narrative way explain why do you think they are the most important 10 key outputs. A key output can be a different, not only publication, but can be a peer-reviewed article or preprint, an open access data, software presentation, everything you in this time understand what could be a key output. Important also is that you can use quality indicators, but only when they are related to one single output item. And as you may know, NWO signed the DORA declaration, so you are not allowed to use or mention the age indexes or impact factors or average citation totals, etc., any metric that refers to a journal or to a publisher. Only you can mention them when you refer to one single output item. This is a kind of new procedure, and if you are interested to know how it works, please take a look at the two links we mentioned here. And there is also a kind of e-learning link where is more detailed explained what DORA means. The assessment criteria. The full proposals, or all the proposals in the case of FIDI, are assessed on three criteria: the proposed research, the quality and the innovative character, the scientific and the societal impact, known until this call as knowledge utilization, and the quality of the researcher. I already saw in the first slide or in the the last Mentimeter question that you are very interested in knowing more about the impact outlook approach. So also here we have an e-learning movie and more information, which you can find on the link of this slide. The time. 2 November deadline and 2 past midnight. Every application received after 2 o'clock will not be processed any further, so be aware of this time slot. Then the assessment procedure will take place until the end of March 22. In April and May there will be interviews, and the decision will follow in June next year. This is the important slide, because as I already stated, I'm not realistic that we can answer all your questions. If you have specific questions or if you have any doubt about where to apply, on which domain, please contact one of the program officers of the different domains. If you have a general question, you can also send your question to talent@nwo.nl. So far, thank you. Now we switch to the question session. So ask your, or write your question down in the chat, and we will try to answer them. Oh yeah. First of all, one of the questions is if we send you this PowerPoint presentation, well, sure, everybody who has registered himself or herself will receive this PowerPoint. Is it possible to submit a similar idea to the VIDI and the ERC starting grant, Oliver?
Well, you can definitely send it to both, to the ERC and the VIDI. Although, well, you have to state in the VIDI that you actually send it to the ERC as well. And in the case that your application will be granted, and we will ask you again if the ERC maybe also has been granted. In that case, you need to decide which one you would like to take. Cannot take both.
I hear I have a question. What should one do if a research proposal seems fit for multiple domains, for example, social sciences as well as applied and engineering sciences? What about the cross-domain option, Jimmy?
Well, in that case, I would suggest that you contact one of the domains to assess which one should be the leading domain where you will then submit. So in any case, it would be important then to contact via the email addresses that were shown previously. And then we can think along and give you advice on where to submit.
Okay, thank you. Are links to video abstracts allowed in the output section? Links to video abstracts.
Well, they are allowed, I think, if that is one of your key output items, then
yes,
you can actually include the link. Otherwise, it's not allowed.
So maybe I can explain that you can use only hyperlinks in these parts of the application form where it is allowed. So take a close look where, in which parts you can use these hyperlinks. Otherwise, you are not asked to use an active hyperlink. Are the dates for the rebuttal or the interviews known? For those of us with small children, school holidays might intervene. Might be important to know beforehand.
So far we planned, as you could see, a kind of period. So, for instance, for the interviews, we have focused on April, May, and with the planning, we focused on in-between holidays, of course, so this is something we took into account. It also depends also on the possibility for committee members to be present, so we will take all of their possibilities in, and then we can define when the interviews will take place. But we are taking care of that it will not be within a holiday period.
Can you reapply with the same project on your second attempt, Oliver?
Yes, you can do, but you should really reconsider the comments of the referees and the committee. So you don't have to choose a different topic, but take into account what the referee said and then adjust your proposal accordingly.
Yeah. A question for you, Jimmy. What are the criteria for the pre-selection by social sciences and humanities?
They are the same three criteria that we could see also in the slide that you showed, Rosemary. So that is the quality of the proposal, it's the impact outlook, and it's the quality of the researcher. So these three criteria are important for the pre-selection. And then for the interview phase is added then the external referees and the interviews as well.
How is the quality of the researcher assessed when we are allowed to provide our full CV?
If you're not allowed to provide the full CV, or not.
Sorry? When we are allowed to provide our full CV.
Well, so what the referee and as well the committee will do is they will look at your narrative CV, and they will also take into account what information you give them. As well as your key output items that you present, that all together will be the base to assess your quality as a researcher.
Are you penalized in the interview for speaking only English? Well, no. That would be not. It's not one of the criteria on which you are assessed. So no, everybody can speak the language of their preference, and mostly the interviews will be in English
or Dutch. Yeah,
or Dutch. Well, you can ask, but sometimes a committee member is only an English speaking. So then all the interviews will take place in English. But it's anyhow not reason to penalize or to receive a lower assessment. That would be not of our procedures. If successful, can you take your VD grant to another institution in Netherlands or abroad?
Not abroad.
Not abroad. Yeah.
You can do that in the Netherlands.
I think if there are issues appearing after a grant is being awarded, it is in the end a personal grant, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. So you are allowed then, if it appears to be not a good fit, that you reconsider, and this is what you do then in consensus with NWO and the host institute, of course.
Well, yeah, it's as I said before, you need an embedding guarantee. If you receive an embedding guarantee of the university you first want to do your research, and you switch beforehand to another university, you need a new embedding guarantee. But the researcher who asked for this now mentions abroad money follows researcher's regeling. Yeah, we know a money follows researcher procedure, but that's only when you already started your VD grant and it's on its way, then there is a possibility to apply for this procedure. There is a description of the money follows researcher procedure on the website, so take a look there, and if you can't find them, please email me and I will give you the more details. What is the purpose of the administrative item month spent since completing your first PhD?
Well, it depends, because not all the applicants are at the same stage in their career. Of course, it's all within 8 years after receiving their PhD. But you have those applicants who only had a few research months yet, and you have those who already had 60. To just give you an example, so it means that a committee can also look at your research months compared to your CV. And so, for instance, if you do not have much experience, for instance, with leadership, and you only have a few research months and you only had your PhD a few years ago, then it's different than someone who is already 60 months of research, for instance, after PhD. So there is a bit of separation there, how a committee can assess what people have been writing down in their CVs.
Yeah. One question which I can answer is the one about maternity leave. How about twins? Well, twins, two children, so two times 18 months, 36 months extension. Is there any data on success rates across the different panels over the last years?
Yes, there are.
There is?
There is, on the webpage of NWO.
Yeah. There is a on the website of NWO. You can find more information about the success rates of the different panels of the last years. Well, let's say about 10 years, I think. Well, you have to take a look at the VD program. So not the financial page, not the application page, but there is also a page which you can find on talentnwo.nl, and which gives you all the information of the applications which are funded, with also a little description of the summary of the content, and then also there is some statistics. If you cannot find that, please send an email and I will send you the link. Must the output be ordered chronologically or according to presumed importance? The 10 key outputs, yeah. Must they?
I don't think there needs to be a chronological order.
No.
I would suggest that doesn't need to be an order in that sense, if you think it's all important, and yeah, probably it is all important. So yeah, I would just suggest that it fits within the narrative how you build it up, because of course, per output you describe what makes it important to you also as a researcher and for your project. So I would say make it a logical build up, but if that's chronologically, you are free to do so.
Yeah. Well, this question is a question we receive each year. What is the minimum FTA for an applicant? I can answer it, but maybe you will do this one, Oliver.
Yeah, I can do it. So for
especially for the health domain, it's important.
Yeah, we think that 0.2 is in principle the minimum we would like to see. But it all depends on your project, and also that's something the committee will take into consideration. So you need to have sufficient time on your project so that you can convince the committee and also the referees that you will be able to successfully can lead your project. So is that not the case, then that's going to be difficult. So there's no strict minimum, but I would advise to take at least 0.2 FTE for your project, which is already quite low.
Yeah, important to say also is that your application must be in balance. So if you are asked with the FIDI to accompany, to help your scientific staff and to help your research line to, there must be a substantial part of your time which you dedicate to help them.
Right. And it's really something the committee will take into account, also the referees. So if there's no clear fit between the time that you spend on your project and the amount of work it's really asked, then will be part of your assessment.
And maybe here it's good to emphasize that maybe, for instance, your institute is willing to pay part of the salary. Then, of course, it's a bit different, because then a 0.2 means that maybe because your institute still pays for part of the salary, as long as you can show to the committee that the time that you invest in it is sufficient to make it a successful project, that's what counts the most. And if there might be a very low number, it could be that a committee asks questions about it, also concerning the feasibility of the project. Yeah.
In terms of applying and the cutoff date since the PhD, do you count the certificate of the defense date? In my case, they are 12 months apart. Well, this is also a question we receive from many foreign researchers, where there is a difference between the defense date and finalizing the thesis. So the defense date is the ceremony when you receive your PhD, and the day you ended your thesis is approved. NWO states that there cannot be more than 6 months between the day of finalizing your thesis when it's approved and the day of the receiving your PhD. Another question. Actual question, how's the reduction in efficiency of working hours due to childcare during the pandemic taken into account? Maybe you can refer to the measures we took already.
One part is that also, of course, due to the hack, but also in this matter, it's the 1st or the 2nd of November that you can submit, so that's already a month later. Also, the call for proposals was made public 4 months before before the deadline. And there will be a section, I think it's 5F, where you can add a little description of how COVID affected you, so the committee can be aware of that. And I think it's something of 100 words that you can spend on writing how it affected you, and then at that way you can make it known to the committee how they should see maybe your outputs.
Yeah, correct. Let's see if there are any more questions which I didn't already. Yes. Does the committee also look how your research proposal relates to previously granted proposals or your specific research field? I don't know who wants to
answer. So previous grants or how that affects?
Yeah, to previous granted proposals. So maybe.
Yeah.
I think you can, when you already received the VENI.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it's important to know, of course, you can mention this in your research profile, and you should mention it. But what we would like to stress is that it's important what you've done with that opportunity of receiving that grant. So only mentioning it doesn't really says much, in the sense, of course, it's an achievement, but we would like to know more and see what you have done with that opportunity. So this is important to emphasize. So we don't expect you to give a list. We want a narrative, and we want to see what kind of opportunities it has given you and what you've done with it.
Thank you. Another question. Now we come to the knowledge utilization section. Oliver, how has the impact section changed with respect to last year? Is implementation still part of the knowledge utilization section?
So since this year, we have the impact outlook approach for the VD. That's the first time that also we are doing this. So what we try to do is, by using the impact outlook approach, you have more freedom to specify if it's only scientific or also societal impact. So if it's only well, we assume that all the projects which are actually sent in, that they have an academic scientific impact. For some, there will be a closer way to also have a societal impact. For other ones, that will be more like a 10-year or even further down the road. So in that case, you can have the opportunity to also state what you do at the moment that during your project that such an opportunity is coming up. So then you need to have really a plan how to facilitate this. So if you then look at the knowledge utilization, how we used to have that, then it was also in the first part the potential you need to describe, and then you had to have your implementation part. So if you already know how you would like to approach also the scientific or the societal impact, and you know in a specific way how to do that, you can of course already write that into your paragraph. For the ones where the only the scientific one is very clear, then you really need only to describe the way how you will facilitate that during the project itself. So.
Well, it's also good to emphasize that the knowledge utilization used to be a one-size-fits-all for all the financial instruments that we have at NWO, also the Dutch Research Agenda, for instance. We realized that knowledge utilization needs a different kind of approach for a different type of instrument. For instance, if it is a societal question that is central, you need a different kind of approach. So that's why we divided it up in three different parts. And the impact outlook is specifically for the talent program research.
Thank you. Another question. In the scientific output section, can we mention the name of the journal?
Yes.
Okay. Another probably short question. What is meant with the reference date for the eligibility? I can answer it.
Okay.
The eligibility date of the VD is the 1st of October. The 1st of October of 21, you cannot have received your PhD longer than 8 years ago. So that is what we mean with eligibility date. It had nothing to do with documents uploaded by the time. So, but only until that date, you're supposed not to have received your PhD longer than 8 years ago.
Unless extension.
Unless closes. Extension. Yeah, sure. Another question. Is it possible or advisable to review or indicate as output and manuscripts that have not been peer-reviewed?
It's important that the output that you mention as a key output, that it is published, or at least that is unconditionally accepted by a publisher, or that we are able to see it online in any way, so that you can mention it as a hyperlink. Whether it's peer-reviewed or not, that's not really important, but it should be published.
Yeah. That's the bottom line, yeah. Another question about the impact outlook approach. Will it be implemented in the other talent schemes also? Where can we find more detailed information on this impact outlook? Well, the hyperlink I wrote down on the slide. There you can find more information also on the website, the general website of NWO. Yes, it will be implemented also in the VENI and the VIKI. So the VIKI call starts next year, then it also will be implemented, and then afterwards in the VENI. So in every open call of NWO, this impact outlook approach will be implemented. What are the main steps or the flowchart an applicant should follow before submitting the VIDI application? For example, is it very important to know when I have to get an approval form? I think you mean an embedding guarantee of the research director of my faculty, or why such an approval is needed? What do you could recommend when a foreign researcher want to do his research here in the Netherlands? What steps should he or she take?
I would suggest that you get in contact with your prospective host institute and get that dialogue going, because it's important that the dean of that institute will in the end sign your embedding guarantee. And with this embedding guarantee, because some of you might already be permanent, but it also obliges the institute to either make you permanent at the end of the VIDI, or at least give you a tenure track position. So it's not a very light choice to make also for an institute. So it's very important to discuss this already early on. So I would start those discussions early.
Yeah, I would say as soon as possible.
Yeah.
is this different in the medical sciences for labs work or anything like that? How
not sure.
Should people get in touch with?
Yeah, I would say, I mean, if you are already at a university in the Netherlands or one of the clinical centers, then there is support by the host institution how to proceed for your VIDI application. But if you're really coming from abroad, then it's really important to have the connection to the group where you would like to do your research beforehand, so that everything can be arranged.
Yeah, a simple one. When is the 21 application form available? It is already available on the website. Let's see, more questions. Well, there are two questions about Aspasia grant. Can one of you answer them? What is the Aspasia grant consideration per domain or on the combined ranking? I don't know what they mean with combined ranking, but maybe you can say anything in general about Aspasia?
Well, what I can say is that those applications that have been awarded will be eligible also for Aspasia. How do you call it? Premi?
Grant.
Mm. Grant, yes. in which also a procedure is started where the university where you are applying will also try to make you associate professor for those that are not associate professor yet. And this also counts for those that are have a qualification after the interviews as very good. So that connects to also a score. But it means that not only those that are awarded a VD will be eligible for it, but it will also mean that those that that receive a very good after the whole procedure, so after interview phase, will be eligible for this. So then NWO will reach out to you with this question, and they will start also the dialogue with your university concerning this matter.
Yeah, and also more information about amounts of money is to find in the call.
Yeah. I think it's 40,000 for those that are awarded the VD and 120,000 for those that are not, that have a very good as a qualification.
I specified because the amounts have been changed last year. So. Does VD fund Blue Sky research, or there should always be a certain degree of applicability or impact to society? I don't know what the exact...
No.
Well...
No, that's not one of the criteria. So if it's innovation-driven research, that's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's different, of course, for the applied engineering science. I mean, there, I think it should be closer to really to be applicable.
Yeah.
But I'm not coming from that domain, so I'm not quite sure. For Zonnewea, mostly all the applications have a close connection to a disease or a health problem. But yeah, it's basic science what you can apply for.
Another question about the extension for maternity or for parents. Do we have to document with written proof maternity paternity leaves in the computation of experience in research teaching?
You mean for the extension?
For the extension, there is a parent declaration, so that's clear. But I think the researcher asks for how to write it down in the CV or in the in the table. Yeah. With
well, so there is a place for that. It's also 5F, where you can also mention your research activities months, and you can also mention your leave there, as well as, for instance, management or other parts. So that's the place where you can list it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, my colleague behind the scenes gave me a notice that the VD application is, when you enter the VD call via Google, then you can find it, because there's an old link, and then you come to the page of the last year call. So please go to nwo.nl. There you can find, if you can search for VD, then you come on the right page. So if you write down in Google VD NWO, then you come to the old page, but we will restore it.
Maybe it's also good to say that for Zonnewea, we have a slightly modified application form. So we don't use ISAC, but mine Zonnewea. So part of what should be in the application form at NWO will be part of mine Zonnewea. It's therefore not included in the application form itself.
And that's not the only difference. The other difference is that for applications in the Zonnewea domain, you must apply by MyZonnewea and not by ISAC, which is for the other three domains. Another question about the impact outlook. The three impact approaches are the impact outlook, very, very well noticed, impact plan, and impact focus approach. Do we need to refer to all three in the proposal?
No.
Only outlook.
Yes.
Only outlook, because the impact outlook is meant for the open...
Yeah, for the more basic science projects.
Where a scientific question is leading.
Yes.
There's
also, I think, kind of a webinar on the page of NWO, which can lead you through steps that you can take for your impact outlook approach. Maybe you can also share the link afterwards if we haven't done that yet.
Yeah, no, sure. I have to scroll all the questions. It's so difficult to choose one of the questions which we can answer here. Is it an official requirement that different work packages, sub-projects, are independent on each other? That's an important question. Are independent on each other?
Yeah, well... I guess for some fields it's difficult to disentangle them, but it's important that that you can make clear, for instance, if you have one project and the other projects really depend on the outcome of the first project, that you make clear how you will deal, for instance, with risks and what if it doesn't work. A committee can ask questions about that, so it's good to be prepared. So it doesn't really have to be completely independent from one another, but if there is a dependency, then it's good to take this into account. If one project really leans on positive results, for instance, for the other project, a committee can ask questions about that.
Another question about working abroad. Can you spend 1 or 2 years during your VD project abroad as a sabbatical to collaborate on your VD project and then return to your Dutch host institute? 2 years.
Well, I guess if you stay affiliated to the Dutch university, I don't see a problem there. If you think of really affiliating to another research, that's not allowed within the VD scheme. So yeah, it depends a bit on working abroad for the Dutch university. I don't see a problem there, but it really to have a contract somewhere else while on VD, that might be no, I don't think that's possible.
Mm-hmm. You do also have PhD students and maybe postdocs you need to supervise, so that's also mm-hmm. something you need to take into account.
So it would be advisable if you plan to do so, write in your application, in your working plan, that you are want to do it, but also be aware that you make a construction that when you are abroad, there is a daily based supervisor. Well, nowadays we are working digital, so that won't be any problem, but it's also nice to have someone concrete in the building where you can come to and ask your question.
Most likely the committee will pick up on that.
Sorry?
Most likely that's a question that the committee will ask you.
Yeah.
Or you're really going to facilitate that.
Can a VD applicant also participate in other NWO calls? For example, co-applicant in Mosaic call. Well, anyhow, you cannot apply for an NWO talent program. You can only apply one at a time. But for the other calls, can one?
I don't know, actually.
I'm not quite sure what the criteria are for the SONMV open competition. There might be a conflict there, but I'm not quite sure.
No.
But it should be stated in the
call.
Yeah.
Every call of NWO has its own procedure. So you can, if you want to do it, a co-applicant in the Mosaic call, please check the Mosaic call if there is any restriction for applying if you are in the running for another talent program call. Can I be the official supervisor of PhD students within the VD project without the last promovendi, or should I always mention an official university prof in that case? I don't really know the answer. No. Do you?
Okay, can you read the idea?
Can I be the official supervisor of PhD students within the VD project? Supervisor, I think, without the ES promovendi. So without possibility to be the...
The promoter.
Promoter.
Yeah.
Or should I always mention official university prof in that case?
No, that's really your project, so don't do that.
Okay.
No, you're going to supervise the PhD students on your project.
Yeah.
And also the postdocs. That's something different, that you cannot be the official promoter in that case. Maybe you will be during your project, mm-hmm. depending on how far you are. But I would not refer to a professor who is then going to do that, because it's your project.
Yeah. And the most important thing is that you supervise these PhD students and bring them to a successful end, and mm-hmm. where the end is under... Who will be the promoter? That's of later care, I think. Where can I find the yearly cost for the PhD postdoc? Well, the salary costs you can find at a table of the VZNU.
But I think it's also listed on the NWO site.
Okay.
So there are there should be a link. But otherwise, if you can send an email, we can give you the right link to find it.
Well, time to some of the last two questions. If we worked in the industry after our PhD, how do we count for this time? Well, maybe it's a question more for the applied and science engineering, but I don't know the answer. Yeah. If we worked in the industry, well, I think it depends on what was the function in working in the industry, because industry also has research.
Right, it could be R&D.
Yeah. Well, something that's a difficult question.
Yeah.
Maybe a more specific question, and send this then to our colleague of the applied and science engineering domain. One question, last question is, should we add societal output under 4B or focus on academic output? 4B is the section with the key output.
Key output, yeah.
So should there be a focus on the should there be a focus on the academic output, or also can one write down the societal output?
I think it's important what you also would like to show to the committee in terms of what you see as important output also for the project you propose. If you have a very important, a very strong societal impact plan, it would be wise to mention an output that shows that you're very capable of doing that. Mm-hmm. So it really depends on how you would like to showcase yourself with the output that you mentioned. So if it's very academic, then you opt differently, of course. So yeah, it's really up to you.
But you always should give proof of your capability as a researcher as well.
Yeah,
I mean, I would not only focus on societal impact.
No, of course, yeah.
Well, time's up. I will show you the last slide with all the information of the different domains. So take a notice of them. And please, we were not able to answer all the questions. So if you have any questions specific for one of the domains, please write an email to one of these domains. And if you have a general question, please send them to talent@nwo.nl. Is there anything you want to add, Jimmy or Oliver?
No, I would like to say thank you very much for attending. It's also good for us to learn from your questions, to see what we can improve also for next time. So also thank you for your attendance.
Yeah, I would say feel free to send us emails or call us if you have any questions.
Thank you very much for attending. We are people, so some researchers think that NWO is only a building with a sack of money, but we are all people. So please start communicating with us. Thank you very much, and I hope to see you next time. Bye bye.